I'm going to introduce Dr. Mollica to the field, practices up in New Jersey. I practice in South Carolina, and what you're looking at is a Southern redneck and a Yankee redneck. We fish together, we have fun together. He's another brilliant practitioner, another one of my mentors and good friends I made in this academy. And I can't tell you how friendly this academy is for the people who are new members and those who haven't joined us yet. You develop friendships coming to these meetings that will last a lifetime with dentists who think, like hopefully you'll be thinking like us. Very open crowd, will tell you everything. As I said before, you can ask questions to any of us. So Dr. Mollica is going to talk on integrative biological concepts for periodontal and associated soft tissue in the oral cavity. It's a big lecture. All right. So I'm going to turn it over to him. If y'all would pass these stickers around, and if you're a non-member, would you put one on? And if you're a new member, would you put one on? We have people looking for you out there, and it will help them identify you. We want to make sure you are comfortable. We're doing everything we need for you at this meeting, and then we're answering all questions. So if y'all could help us out, they got lost in the mail, and we would have had it all done. I would appreciate it.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Hello. Has Elvis left the building yet? Can you hear me now? Oh, that's a good response. You people awake or what? Come on, wake up. Woo, come on. It's supposed to be fun right now. Oh, great. I must be talking to the dentist. I know you. Can you turn this up a little bit? I want to sing a little bit before we get going. How's that? Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. All right. Well, it's a pleasure being here in Las Vegas, and I just flew in from Jersey last night, so if anybody gets out of hand, you know what happens in Jersey. Forget about it, okay? So we're going to have some fun today. You know, my kind of assignment, I'm the chairman of the Periodontal and Soft Tissue Management Committee, okay? But I think more important here, and I'm supposed to talk about periodontal care, which we're going to talk about, but more importantly, you know, the concept of biologic dentistry. Great. I'm a biologic dentist. I'm a holistic dentist. I don't know what the hell I am, okay? But my job today, I think, more importantly, is let's just start thinking differently. Let's start thinking really biologically, getting back to our basics of why things happen, you know, what clinical representations, what do they really mean biologically? You know, we're going with perio, and classically, you know, we've attacked periodontal care just really by what? Treating everything inside the pocket. I mean, that's our world. Go in there, scrape it up, clean it up, you know, drug them up and hope for the best. And the basis for success has always been, well, we do kind of cool things in the office. Yeah, we clean them up and give them home care instructions and all that. But also, do they do their homework? I mean, we do all kinds of cool stuff, but they don't take care of their own, you know, their mouth and take, you know, become their own greatest advocates. Nothing we do will really, really work well. So we're going to talk a little bit different. We're going to think differently. I like thinking differently. I was just up in Alaska, and definitely you have to think differently, right, Greg? But the fishing was very good. Appreciate that. That turned out to be wonderful. Especially, you know, when the sun doesn't set, it goes down and kind of peaks back up. I can see where all the crazy people live up there. I like it. Must be scary when it's dark all the time. Don't you think about that? Woo, scary. Anyhow, so the Periodontal Associated Soft Tissue Committee, this is our mission statement, and I'll quickly read it to you so it's official, and then we can move on and have some fun. The mission of the Periodontal Associated Soft Tissue Committee of the International Academy of Oral Medicine Toxicology is to educate, promote, and support practitioners in current emerging biologic therapies and periodontology. The therapies must be safe, effective, biologically based, which ultimately provide preferable outcomes for patients and the practitioners. And it's important that, you know, patient and practitioners, that relationship, and I'm a big one for sustainable relationships, good team relationships with that. And we really know when you talk about periodontal disease, it's linked to all kinds of systemic problems. You know, we've seen a cardiac, vascular, you know, preterm births. We've seen this again and again. And, you know, really, what is all that about? Why are something that when we're taught in dental school, well, really, in dental school, what? Does anything exist below the jawbone? There's nothing down there. and just drags the head around. Well, it's a little bit more than that. That's so. And we think about the oral systemic link. You know, how much do we know? Well, we really, one fundamental concept is we are but one. There are no barriers in the human body. You know, when I went to anatomy school, you know, we're taught all different little dinks and dents and pieces and that. And at that time, I came out of college. I was working on that master's degree and working on dead people. So I didn't understand the connectivity, the biologic flows, all those things. It was just, little dead people laying there with pieces, okay? But we are but one. We function as one. Your body does not understand bits and pieces. It understands itself as a whole thing. So anything that happens in the body has far-reaching implications, and we understand that a little better. So we're hopping out of the box, and that's the beauty of this academy. You know, I've belonged to different dental groups over the years, and I must be from New Jersey. Hey, forget about it. Anyhow, when I came to this academy back in Crystal City, Virginia, this is years ago, I was invited to attend the meeting by a friend of mine, Rich Fisher. And I must tell you, this is an incredible place to be. I hate dental snobbery, and you're not going to find that here. The amazing thing you find with this group of people, the most giving individuals I've ever met in my life. It's like one big family. And I got to tell you, talk to the members, they'll help you with anything. And it's a wonderful, wonderful, warm place to be. Sometimes you've all gone to dental meetings, it's like, ooh, I can't escape this too quickly. But this, and you all know what I'm talking about. Like, oh, please. But this is a great, great, loving place and a great place to call home. That's for sure. And I've been here a long time and I plan to be here for quite a while. So anyhow, let's get back to, let's think out of the box. Let's get out of the box. And let's start with the epithelial cell. The epithelial cell. Why as dentists should we care about the epithelial cell? Now you can feel free. This is not dental school, by the way. We can talk. Remember dental school? I used to sleep through dental school, but that's another story. It's 8 a.m. classes. How ridiculous. So why should we care about the epithelial cell? Well, look at your mouth, man. What is that made up of? Epithelial cells. And the nature of those epithelial cells, the health and wellness of your clinical outcomes and how the patient feels and how the patient functional cavity in the oral cavity is based on how the epithelial cell functions. Epithelial cells are cool, man. They hang out together. They love the cuddle. Their pal's not feeling well. They'll share a little of their stuff with them. They are important, important cells. So when you think about the epithelial cell, it is an important aspect of the oral cavity. But when you think about the cell, we're all taught in, when I started, maybe college or whatever, in biology, I think when I started my first biochemistry course, it was Stickmen, little models now, not three-dimensional thing. But anyhow, the concept of the cell, we're always taught a cell is a little cube, has a bunch of cool stuff in it. There's a nucleus in the middle, which everybody thought was the brain of the cell itself, okay? But really, it's a really morphological abstract. It really is a reflection. Cells are a reflection of the environment they're in. Depending on that ecology and environment, those cells will reflect that. A good, healthy, functional environment, good, healthy cells. A dysfunctional, toxic environment, you'll see that reflection. And why? Well, let's see why. Now, Bill Virtue's in the back, and you're going to hear about, Bill's going to talk about this afternoon, and I know he got in last night, and I know he was flying in, and Bill always thinks about these things. How does oxygen get to a cell? Right, Bill? Oh, yeah, see? How do nutrients get to a cell? How do metabolic waste, how did the poop and pee from a cell get out of the cell? Where does it go? And what's the cellular ecosystem? And what is a cellular matrix or terrain? What is that all about? And how do slides disappear hitting the wrong button? So when you think about it, going back in the history of medicine and dentistry, which it probably still is today, we think in linear terms. Linear terms. That perfect margin in dental school. That perfect casting. Cause and effect. Going back to Galileo, Virchow, organisms, we're a machine. We're a mechanism. We just function as a machine. we can fix ourselves. Give something to key lock, you know, drugs, boom, fixed. Fantastic. Straightforward thinking. And this is, you know, how, you know, illnesses are, you know, corrected. We give you an antibiotic or a drug and we see the effect. Wow, that can be, we can, you know, verify it, take a good look at it. Fantastic. It can be objectified. We can see that. The problem we have today, and we're seeing more and more, people are living longer and things are different. You know, we can deal with acute situations, absolutely. But it's when the model really doesn't fit into where we're moving in today, which is the world of chronic disease. How many of your patients today have chronic problems? Okay? Tumors, chronic fatigue, Lyme disease. How many patients do you see with Lyme disease or syndrome? I mean, this goes on and on and on. So we're dealing with a different half. We have to think differently. You know, you just can't. You know, the amazing thing about, let's say, I call it Lyme syndrome, because we deal with a lot of that, those issues up in the Northeast. And you give an antibiotic, it works or it doesn't work. Am I correct? Why did people put on antibiotics for 6 months of the same antibiotic? It will work. What are you doing if you have someone on an antibiotic for 6 months? Are you destroying what? Their immune system, their gut. Where does the immune system live in your body? In the gut. That's the thing we should be nurturing. Where does the gut begin? Right here, right there. This is a reflection of what goes on down below. Well, we know where it ends, but we won't go there today. So we're dealing with a different situation. Our patients are sort of different. You know, we can handle those acute situations. That's cool. We can deal with that. But now we're dealing with chronicity and really physiologic, ecologic changes in these patients. We have to really help guide them at it. It's really not an overnight process. So the model that we work in, so our model, is what we call it integrated biologic dental medicine, because in the biologic world, we try to define ourselves. What does a biologic dentist mean? What does a holistic dentist mean? Well, we try to define ourselves so we have some at least guidelines to work with. So we try not to think in a linear fashion. What we like to do is really look at the root cause, regardless of what you're seeing disease-wise. What is driving? What are the underpinnings of what's going on? Why is this patient having chronic perio problems? Why are they losing bones or rap? Is it just a localized issue? Or are there deeper issues? What's going on them? Step back. It's a whole organism, by the way. We focus on the individual, you know, what's the patient's experience? You know, you all have patients that, you know, oh, how you doing, Mr. Smith? Great, okay. What'd you do this week? Well, I saw this doctor on Monday. I saw my, you know, physical therapist twice on Tuesday, and the other physician, it's like, becomes a lifestyle. It's lifestyle, and that's what we don't want, to live. So we want to understand what biological underpinnings are processes, and think about the phenomenon of being sick. What is that all about? So in biologic systems, which are amazing, when you start different thinking, you're thinking differently. You know, we're taught in dental school, you know, very linear. I think dental school is extremely linear, you know, very mechanical in a way, but you're transcending to a different way of thinking. Biologic systems are not linear at all. There are no straight lines in the human body. Everything is curved and contoured. Everything is completely interlinked. When you take that, you know, 27-gauge needle and do that inferior alveolar block, believe me, your little toe feels it. Well, how can that be? And we are energetic beings. We are energy-based. It's an open energetic system that flows and ebbs where you need it, where you need that energy. And your body, as a biologic system, can exchange that energy, move it around as necessary. We talk about Chinese medicine, qi, etc. That's the basic concept there. In open systems, our enough energy can spread through the entire system. Energy is our healing methodology. But it's interesting that this energy, this flow of information, is the most critical aspect for the human body. Your body is an amazing organism. The information that flows through it makes every computer, the supercomputers, look pale compared to the amount of information that travels around the body. When information becomes chaotic, information is not being traveled through the system, given to the epithelial cells, they start acting dopey. Information is key. The most suitable energy carrier is information. And this information is provided by the extracellular matrix. Anybody hear of the extracellular matrix before? Bill did. All our students better heard about that matrix. We're going to talk about that now. The extracellular matrix in traditional thought was the stuff that supported our tissues and cells, just kind of held us together, the glue. You might even think of it terms in kind of fascia in a way. So it was termed, you know, thought about as a structural component. Well, that's not really true. The extracellular matrix is the unifying theory of the human body. If you took everything away, all the tissue except the extracellular matrix, you would have a perfect form of your human body. Every function, everything associated with cells and tissue and function is associated with the extracellular matrix. This is the interface. When you think about it, a capillary. It's running along, has a nice little capillary loop, a little tiny thing. What is it? Just go, oh, here's my epithelial cell. Oh, I'm rubbing. Oh, here's some oxygen. I'll take some carbon dioxide away. I'll take some of your, you know, your poop and your pee away. And, well, let's dump some hormones. I'll dump there. No, it doesn't work that way. The extracellular matrix is a highly regulated, intelligent, autonomic area of your body. Everything that goes to your cells, which ultimately reflects in your tissue and organ systems, flows through the matrix. Oxygen, carbon dioxide, hormones, your immune system travels through there. Highly regulated, intelligent area. So if you look at our cell, you have all this information, growth factors, cytokines, hormones, vitamins, cell-to-cell contact via the matrix, the growth, shape, differentiation, develop metabolic responses. So if you think about it now, even if we look at the periodontium, the soft tissue, we're trying to nurture our epithelial cell. If your extracellular matrix isn't functioning right, toxic, not allowing proper information to go, you're going to see reflection in the tissue. When you think about it, an epithelial cell needs constant information. Where is the brain of a cell? Where's the brain? Well, certainly not the nucleus. That's a protein factory. That is a reflection of information coming in. The cell of a, you know, the cell membrane is the brain of a cell. That's where the information is. Cell membranes are highly intelligent and highly regulated. So the extracellular matrix really is a complex aggregate of different macromolecules. It's amazing the concept behind here. You know, the proteins, the sugars, the matrix, the supporting structures, the elastin, you know, the connective tissue. As we can see here, all these high polymers, these sugar complexes, and it's amazing that it structurally supports the cells, yet it's allowed, once again, this highly controlled, highly autonomic area to allow the flow of all this information, metabolic waste, oxygen, nutrients, back and forth to the cell. And here's a simple model of the matrix itself. You can see our little capillary here. And you think about this, you know, you have endothelial cells, you have the matrix here, and you have your cells here. And once again, epithelial cells love contact. They have little links in here. They have little ports going back and forth. This is all linked in. This is but one thing. So this process allows all this information to flow into the cells, and the cellular metabolic byproducts, whether it's hormones, whatever the cells are producing, allows it to flow out in an intelligent, good fashion. So we can see where this is critically important for the health and the wellness of the cells. So we're transcending from just the simple epithelial cells, but how the cells are supported and nurtured via the body itself. So this is where we see the extracellular matrix is really the unifying biologic field in the human body. We can see the amazing aspects that we understand now about the human membrane, the cell membrane itself, and how it is all connected here. This is your matrix in here. This is where information flows, all those things I spoke about, and intimately connected into the cells. Everything is but one. We're but one thing. Everything is connected. There are no spaces, no gaps, no nothing. It's all but one. We are all linked in to one organism. So the human body, of course, is an open energetic ecosystem. And that's what's really important, is that we are little ponds. We are ecosystems where we have chronic infection, chronic inflammation, disease. That reflects throughout the entire ecosystem. It's the ecological issues. So with the triad of functional life, we talk about the capillary, the cell, and the extracellular matrix. So when we're in there treating our perio, now we're transcending. How are we going to nurture those epithelial cells to make them function better? So how should we approach that? It's just a silly thing, scrape, clean it up. Yeah, that's an aspect of it, but it might go deeper than that. But you know, the human body is amazing. It's amazing what abuse it can take. You know, when I was in anatomy school, I mean, we saw all these bodies. We went through, dissected, I don't know how many bodies. And I didn't know anything about clinical aspects. But I would look at these bodies. It's just amazing the abuse we can do to ourselves until, you know what? We're done. Until we, you know, finally make that tip over. It's amazing what we can do. But, you know, factors that influence, you know, cell biology, of course, the matrix, growth factors, information, nutrients, how cells contact each other, the information flowing back and forth, beyond just the genetic programming. Okay? Beyond the genetic program. Genetic programming has a part to do with it, but more important is how you treat and nurture this ecosystem itself. And the body, we've heard this, you know, years since we've, you know, got our degrees in biology or whatever, biochemistry, whatever the case may be, we're all homeostasis. I want to be balanced, man. Yeah, I want to be balanced, okay? So homeostasis, the body always works towards to be balanced and function the best it can. And this goes, you know, this definition goes back to 1929, the coordinated physiological processes which maintain the steady state of the organism. It's amazing what we do to ourselves that we can still balance ourselves, even though sometimes as we move along and mature, some things get a little stiff and rigidy, but that's okay. We want to be balanced. We have a wonderful thing that we see all the time. We don't appreciate. We have biologic elasticity. We can heal ourselves. Dental healers. That's a concept. Biologic elasticity. You know, it's amazing. The human body, people, winter storms, drought, accidents, predators, living in Alaska. Okay? Hunger, thirst. We can react to that and bounce back and function well. But it fundamentally boils down to health and wellness of your human body is based on the ecology. Ecology, and how you function with that. And, you know, the ecology of the human body, we talk about the microbes maketh man. The big thing is the microbiome. We are well outnumbered by the things we grow. We are the ultimate petri dish, believe me, on your skin, in your lungs, on your gut. But we have a good, you know, relationship, hopefully, with the bugs we live with. And they're trying to figure out what the microbiome of the human body is. And you know what? Everyone has a different ecosystem. And your ecosystem will reflect what you grow. If you look at people with chronic disease, okay, Lyme syndrome, all those bugs are almost transforming that person's ecosystem to a favorable environment. The only way I've ever seen Lyme patients and cancer patients really cured is when they change their ecology, change the chemistry of their body, change the bugs that live within themselves, detoxify, get the poisons out, change the ecology. And everyone's ecology is different. So in our world of dentistry, which is, you know, biohazard world, I don't know if we should live in a bubble or not, but I guess you'll see that this afternoon. You know, it's amazing. When I was in dental school, we used to take, you know, take shots of methylmercaptan. Everybody did that, right? No, you didn't do it. Okay, great. It was the 70s, man. No, okay. So, you know, we played methylmercaptan, asbestos. So we did all this crazy stuff. That's what we still deal with it today. So we're dealing with chemicals, solvents. You know, in homeopathy, everybody familiar with homeopathy? Now, homeopathy is an amazing thing. Okay, it works wonderfully. But originally, homeopathy was built around sanitation issues. Because that was the times, you know, back in the 1800s. What's homeopathy about today? Environment. It's all environmental homeopathy. That's really the thing. And this is a reflection of our world. I mean, we're dealing with chemicals, solvents, infection, our response, our body's response to infection, heavy metals, environmentals all the time, all different types of heavy metals. You know, just drink some tap water. That's good for you. Oof. Those all contribute to what we call anaerobiosis or dysregulation of the system itself, things that change. So, you know, it's amazing. We're like the ultimate fighter jet. You know, fighter jets are amazing because they're so unstable, they function incredibly well. And we're like the ultimate fighter jet, you know. We're very unstable, but somehow this crazy system we had, you know, maintains its stability and we can function, get up every day, do all the cool things we do. But sometimes, you know, misunderstandings, things, you know, communication's not going, things aren't doing well, and misstep here, we stumble here, eventually things accumulate. You know, when we see, you know, disease states, chronicity in these patients, these syndromes we're seeing with a chronic fatigue, Lyme, whatever the case may be, it just didn't happen overnight. You know, cancers don't happen overnight. This is a slow accumulation, an environmental slow accumulation change in the body's ultimate response to that. So we fall into that free fall into disaster. So when we talk about the matrix, you know, today it's a big thing. You know, I want to detox and I want to alkalinize myself. Okay? I want to be more alkaline. Why? Because I'm afraid of chronic disease. I'm afraid of cancer. So cancer doesn't do well in a well-oxygenated alkaline system. So when we alkalinize ourselves, we're drinking, what, lemon water, drinking more green things, all those wonderful things that keep us functioning better. What are we alkalinizing? What are we alkalinizing? Well, are you alkalinizing the blood? No, you cannot. You'll kill yourself. Okay? Are you alkalinizing cells? Well, maybe indirectly. What you're ultimately doing is alkalinizing the matrix. This is what you're doing because the extracellular matrix functions best when it's more alkaline and well hydrated. Which, remember, if you become more toxic, more acidic, information can't flow, you're not getting good oxygen to the cells, and those cells are going to reflect that environment. So as our matrix starts to collapse, it'll accumulate toxins, heavy metals, you're drinking your fluoride water every day for good nutrition, right? All right, doing, you know, having all this kind of acidic lifestyle, stress, etc. The matrix itself is becoming dysfunctional and doesn't allow for the proper flow of information in, information out, all the things that we need to live and function well to the cells, and those poop and pee not getting out. And it reflects all the way down through your immune system, circulatory system, right across the way. So before we start to see our clinic-based diagnosis and what we see clinically in the patient, a lot of stuff has happened already. They're well down the road. Because the matrix started to become dysfunctional, became toxic, became infected. The byproducts of this infective state, okay? The toxins. You get abnormalities in the extracellular matrix. We start to see the cells start to wane because they're not getting the nutrients, the proper oxygenation and information they need, okay? When cells get bad information, especially epithelial cells, they start producing weird proteins. When those weird proteins start to produce, the cell's going to reflect that, and slow and behold, over time, guess what? You got a crazy-ass cancer going on. Because they're not getting the proper information. We ultimately see patho-ecological drifting, and then ultimately we see the disease state come about. So it's a slow, insidious process that starts deeper, okay, bad information, clogged, dysfunctional system, and then eventually we see clinically this disease state. So we're a reflection of ecology. We have, you know, an anaerobiotic, which I'll explain in a minute, dysregulated environment, bad information. And what we try to do is ecologically shift to a balanced, well-regulated environment. Meaning regulated, meaning your body's function at an autonomic level properly to get all the information, everything necessary to support health and wellness. and we talk about infection, just a quick side note. I always talk about mixed infection, but you know what? We don't even know what the hell grows down there. You don't know. Most times, and we'll talk about different assessments with periodontal care, but we're not really sure what grows at different times. We tried some denasalis, but that's kind of restricted unto itself. So eventually, we want to get a regulated environment, change the ecology, that makes the matrix function better, get all the nutrients necessary, and change that ecology through a harmonic ecosystem, which is called homeostasis and health. And we use our model of integrated biologic therapies to really change that dysregulated environment and start so it's regulating that the body is doing the healing itself. Okay, the body must heal itself. Remember that with your patients. Okay, ultimately, I always tell my patients, some of them come in, heal me. I'm like, oh, brother, we got problems. They have to heal themselves. They have to be their own advocates. Only they can heal themselves. Now, we can help them heal themselves, but we're there to support that healing process within themselves. So this anaerobiotic dysregulated environment, we see that what's called oxidative vascular lymphatic congestion. And we see that where? On periodontal disease or ischemic disease within the jaws. The system becomes clogged. It's not draining properly. We're not getting good blood flow in, blood flow out, good lymphatics in, good lymphatics out. We see that in the congested tissue and ultimately the vascular beds and the matrix start to dysfunction. We're seeing problems like this today, and this is representative of osteonecrosis of the jaw. Now, this is from poison, bisphosphonates, okay? We're seeing this, and this is really dysregulated tissue. This is where the system was poisoned, the matrix broke down, the bone is dying, the vascular beds are collapsing, the matrix goes with it, bad information, the tissue just doesn't know what to do with itself. And we ultimately wind up with what we call this disease state, a reflection of a collapse of the matrix, blood supply, etc. And I've had this picture for a while. I love showing it because everybody goes like, nee. It's like, you know, can you identify this man's piece of his head? Well, what this really is his maxilla, and this is the floor of his maxillary sinus. And when this came out, you go, ooh, what the hell is that? That was an interesting day. So this is dysregulation, and it's induced by a poison. A poison that goes in and destroys in a nice ecological balance between osteoblasts and osteoclasts. But that's for another discussion. But if you support the system, you help the body. You help it detoxify. You put the information in, you support the healing process, you can get this to start to regulate again. And that's part of our job, to recognize this dysregulated tissue, understand what's going on toxic-wise with the patient, patient as a whole, what the hell's going on, why is this happening, and we can start re-regulating the tissue. Where in this case, we're using a combination of homeopathics, procaines, different remedies together with ozone therapy, which we'll talk a little bit about, to get this tissue regulated again, cleaning up the infection, changing ecology, reestablishing the matrix and the vascular beds, and allowing the patient to heal themselves. So we can do this with this. Certainly we can manage periodontal care pretty well. So in the model we think about, and this is all important, whether you use the integrated model or not, there's no one bullet out there. There's no one thing that's the miracle cure. That's why I love the concept of integration, because we can pull from different areas and combine therapies in a more comprehensive manner. You know, fundamental concepts like, first thing, good hydration. You know, you always ask the patient, well, let's talk about a couple of things we always ask our patient when they come in. First thing, you poop every day. They say, what? Yeah, you take a crap every day. Is this the proctology department? Well, we're on the other end, but it's important. I mean, our practice is right outside Manhattan, so we kind of get Holly Weirds and all that kind of cool stuff. So in the models, you know, and, I go to the bathroom. Well, how often? Oh, once a week. Hey, man, you're full of shit, man. You know, you're not feeling well. Why are the gums puffy and you're like bad breath? You know, things are backing up. If you hear a little lump in your throat, you've really gone too far. That's important. You got to crap and pee. Well, listen, to be healthy, what are the few things you got to do? Well, you got to sweat real good, okay? You got to breathe well. Breathing is fundamental. Get that oxygen levels up, okay? And you got to poop and pee. That's how you get rid of things, okay? How do you get rid of heavy metals and stuff? Well, the best way is poop them out. You know, you can sweat them out, etc. Okay? You got to poop, pee, sweat, and breathe. You know, that's how you detox. But fundamentally, you do those things, but also hydration is critical. How much water do you drink today? I have a cup of coffee. No. How much water do you drink today? I have a cup of coffee. That's not going to do it for you. Hydration is critical. The more hydrated you are, the better your body is going to function, the better the matrix is going to function. Because without the matrix functioning, we know now what? The cells are not going to function well. Hydration. Detoxification. If I'm going to detoxify myself, I'm taking all these wonderful remedies and stuff. If you're not hydrated, man, you're going to get sick as hell. You'll start mobilizing stuff. There's no place to go. Water is the ultimate universal what? Solvent. So you have to be well hydrated to flush that stuff out. And we've been, you know, with the integrative model, we bring in naturopathy, homeopathy, whatever the patient needs, that's what we center our focus, our therapies around. It's wonderful working with integrated physicians and dentists. It's a wonderful model to work in. And this is my good son, not wanting it up on Monday. That's Tankenstein. So ultimately, if you treat him right, he'll pop right out of the bed there. Looks like his dad, doesn't he? And my wife's back there, she's going to kill me. So the pathway to wellness, we want to repair, restore, renew. But ultimately, the onus goes on to the patient themselves. So in the integrative model, we really want to understand and assess the patient beyond just their oral cavity. What the hell's going on with them in their life, their nutrition, et cetera. You know, with different therapies, as you get to understand homeopathy or herbal medicines, those type of things, you know, you start out a little slow and you can always build your remedies up to see how the patient responds to that. And of course, you know, the patient has lesions or whatever the case may be, don't forget about the healthy stuff, the healthy tissue. Support that. Eventually get the infective titer down, but more importantly, change the symbiotic microorganisms that live with you. Change that to a better environment for you. Give some initial foundational therapies, clear the pathways of draining, meaning make sure they're pain and poo and all the things we just spoke about. And then we can get into these deeper infections themselves. So we put all the pieces together. We're talking about infection, microbiome, biologics, and diagnostic with the underpinning of that matrix now. Thinking about that matrix a little bit more. How can we support that? And that will ultimately reflect into the tissue itself. So we always want therapies that are safe and effective, non-toxic, really no side effects, and allow the patient to heal themselves and ultimately reaching their state of biologic homeostasis. Now, no side effects. Well, listen, everybody familiar with the Herxheimer reaction? Sometimes as you're detoxifying, you can get flu-like symptomologies, okay? We try to avoid that, but if that's the worst case scenario in toxicity versus anything else, that's a great way to go. Now, does everybody appreciate, you know, you watch TV, okay? Does everybody appreciate the pharmaceutical commercials? Is that great? Everything is about bone and boners these days. Am I right? Yes. You good bone and a good boner, you got it made. Great. True. But I like the side effects. Even if you're dead, call us. It's okay. Oh, that's the law one that goes on after the commercial, right? So this will help you. Yes, you'll be able to soak in a nice tub. It's a beautiful thing. Oh, yes. Oh, darling. When the moment strikes. Yeah, it struck. Okay. Oh, brother. So that's Darlin Tank had a meditative moment. He took his Viagra, but no luck. Anyhow, so when you think about it, you know, our principal goals, when you think differently and biologically, is really supporting or nurturing the matrix, okay, the matrix, and the epithelial cell, and ultimately that will reflect in healthy tissue and a nice little happy smile itself. So let's talk about healing and supporting periodontal and the associated soft tissue itself. Healing, a little bit different, a little bit concept of healing itself. We saw this kind of concept a little bit before. You know, we have a toxic, you know, anaerobic microbiome that's toxic, producing all kinds of weird things. And we want to shift it ecologically to a friendly microbiome. We want a better ecology, let's say, in the oral cavity and the body itself. We're always dealing with mixed infection itself. So I've been talking about, hey, this is from Jersey water. You got a problem? A little nasty down there. This is always good when patients, oh, listen, I've been practicing 32 years. Yeah, 32 years. When you start forgetting how long you practice, you know you got a problem. And people come, I got a tumor in my head. So you go in there, where? Oh, it's by my tongue. It's been growing. You look in there. I go, So of course you take your jackhammer and blast it away. And then they complain, oh, my teeth are sensitive. So I get the plaster quick. So when we talk about anaerobiosis, this goes back to the work of Otto Warburg. You know, it's a two-time Nobel winner back in the 30s. And he discovered the root causes of cancer, the fermentation process, and the shifting metabolically from an aerobic oxygen-based metabolism, which we love, to a more of a sugar-based, you know, metabolism, a fermentation process. When you think about it, oxygen-wise, you know, we have an oxygen metabolism. We're producing, what, maybe 36 ATP, which is our energy packets. When our body ecologically shifts and starts burning sugars, we're down to about 2 ATP. So you see those chronic fatigue, those patients that are locked in there and not methylating correctly, a whole process going on, they're shifting metabolically. And that's a reflection, once again, ecologically, biologically. So what happens is with anaerobiosis, I've been tossing that term out to you. It's an altered pathologic state of oxygen metabolism. Okay, we're not using oxygen properly at functional metabolic levels. It's a fermentation process, and this is where uncontrolled oxidative injury occurs. Things are burning badly. We're producing a lot of, you know, oxidative stress on those cells. The matrix is collapsing. This is where we see that. Now, when you have some perio patients come in, and patients in general, how many have come in and you've seen that they're fermenting all right, right? Hello, fermentation. Nice. So that's that fermentation process. Things are shifting in their whole body, and it's really reflecting also through the oral cavity itself. We are but one. So this concept of oxygen metabolism can be affected by biotoxins, biocides, heavy metals, which is our world, okay? You got to protect yourself appropriately, pesticides, solvents, and of course, our favorite, you know, the viruses, the bacteria, the fungus, the parasites, and creating this anaerobiotic environment. That really is not an environment that's conducive to health and functionality and homeostasis. So in periodontal infection, okay, we're seeing really uncontrolled oxidative injury. We're seeing clinically, we're seeing that vascular and lymphatic congestion. We're seeing that peripheral tissue, that bloody tissue, the touch of the tissue, it just collapses apart. Those epithelial cells not functioning correctly. They don't know what the hell to do with themselves. Okay, it's an ecological condition. You're getting these microbes that are adapting. This is great. They're opportunistic. You know, so anaerobiosis is functional oxygen metabolism, and it becomes dysregulated. Bad information. They don't know what the hell to do with themselves, and we're seeing that clinically. And we want to shift that environment using biology, biologically based therapies. We go back to the oral systemic link. You know, gravity sucks, man. All those byproducts of those crazy bugs in there, they're pooping and peeing. Guess where it's going? Draining down into your system itself. There are no barriers in the human body. When you have chronic infection, it is everywhere. Everywhere. And we're all infected, that's for sure. And once again, what our ecology is, that's a reflection of what you grow. You have an acidic, disoxygenated environment, that's what you're going to grow. You have a healthy, oxygenated, healthy environment, that's what you're going to grow. So it's going to be interesting to see how that reflects out. So your microbiome is a reflection of you. What grows on this thing? Think about it. So you are, you know, grow what you are based on hydration, you know, what you eat, your habits, your sleep, supplements, living environment, and the hygiene of your entire body itself. So the biofilm, but the interesting thing about all these bugs, we talk about the microbiome, okay? They live in what we call what? Biofilm. Now, biofilm is very interesting. It's well organized. All these guys, these bugs, all speak to themselves. They all hang out together. They have a grand time. It's, you know, they have built a nice little city. They have condos, high rises, split ranches. They have roads. They have garbage dumps. They find a place to live. And guess what? Hey, move in. They're having a grand time. And unfortunately, you're the victim of that. Now, it could be good or it could be bad. And they always speak the same language called cytokines. They all speak the same language. It's called cytokines, the language of chemicals. They share chemicals, and where do those chemicals go? Well, their cell membranes, and this is how they communicate. And they live in a nice, dark world. Listen, think about the perio pocket, you know, and you're kind of a bug hanging out. Ooh, it's nice. It's dark. It's wet. Ooh, here comes a Mars bar. We're good, man. Life is good. All right. And what is dental biofilm? Plaque. Plaque. Okay, remember from dental school, painting everything pink? Oh, doctor, you missed that spot. You get it. You don't pass for today. Okay. But the biofilm allows these things to communicate, allows a great place for them to live. It's their defense shield. It protects them. Because we look at a bacterial plaque, you know, a bacteria in a biofilm is 1,000 times more resistant to antibiotics than the same bacteria that stripped the biofilm. So now here's another level of thought. Whatever we do to eliminate these bugs or pathogens, whatever you want to call them, it has to first get through what? The biofilm. You have to get through the biofilm first. If the antibiotic can't get through the biofilm, it's not going to work. And a lot of studies were done at the University of Montana, Montana State. You know, they're looking at different biofilms in the oral cavity and throughout the entire body. The biofilm is everywhere, everywhere. Now let's take a look at the dark world of biofilm, if it works. This is your brain on biofilm. It's a great little film. It shows the development of the biofilm and the bugs. They're not stupid. They are certainly not stupid at all. They're well organized. They talk to each other. And they build. And they're in you. Here come our favorite spirochetes. We'll talk about microscopy also in a little bit down the road, but those are assessment tools that we can look at. You take a little sampling. I think Bill Anders is here this weekend from Oratech. I think he'll set up his phase contrast microscope. Take a look at that. That's a nice tool to educate your patient. You have now entered the Twilight Zone. Kiss me, baby. Thank you. Give me that. Give me some of that love, honey. Hey, man, it's all communicable disease. Hey, pass it around. A friend of mine used to say, you get periodontal disease from wives, lovers, and dogs. I said, John, where'd you get this dog thing? Don't ask. Ooh. Kiss the dog. All right, so it gives you a sense of what, now this, what's growing in your mouth, and growing everywhere, so well organized. So we have to get through this biofilm to get to these, let's call them the pathogenic forms. So the American Dental Association came out with an article, it's a great article. You know, One of the most important aspects of treating periodontitis is you need a strong oxidizing agent to get through what? The biofilm. Okay, strong oxidizing agents. You know, what could those be? What can those be to get, you know, get through the biofilm without killing the patient? You know, we don't want to do chemotherapy. Let's see who lives. Okay? So we need a strong oxidizing agent to dissolve that biofilm matrix itself. And, you know, there are different studies out there, the effect of the autoimmune response to periodontal disease. And it's interesting, some of the research out there now, that's they're trying to connect the response of the immune system to the chronic infection. The immune system might be doing more of the bony damage and supporting damage than the pathogens themselves, our body's response to that. So we have to take that in consideration, the reflection of how our body is responding. It could possibly, we're destroying ourselves, autoimmunity within the periodontium itself. So let's talk about periodontal concepts and some suggestions that we might have for you. One of the most important things, first of all, is educating the patient. It takes time to make the awareness. You know, the problem with what periodontal disease is what? You don't feel it. We had a couple of patients come in the other night, husband and wife. Wife had incredibly advanced periodontal disease, and the husband had moderate to advanced periodontal disease. We took x-rays, little tips of bones here and there. But, you know, and it's like, wow, I didn't know I had all these problems, because you don't feel it. So important that we educate the patient on the ramifications, not just beyond keeping their mouth clean and supporting the tissues in there, but the effects on the whole body. You know, scare them a little bit, I guess. But, you know, get that patient well educated. So the American Academy of Periodontology, on the risk assessments, we talk about risk assessments, okay? And you can get this little list from www.perio.org, you know. How old are you? Are you male or female? Do your gums ever bleed? Are your teeth loose? Have your gums receded? Do you smoke or do you use tobacco products? Have you seen a dentist in 2 years? You know, when was the last time you did this? Oh, 12 years ago. Seems like yesterday, okay? How often do you floss? You know, do you currently have any health conditions? If the health conditions, you know, are a major problem. Have you been, you know, told you have gum problems in the past? You know, you have teeth extracted. You know, you have family members have gum disease. And another one on there, what kind of pharmaceuticals are you taking? How many people are dealing with these dry mouths these days off those drugs? That's murder. You know, they come in with a bag of, you know, I'm taking this drawn drug for this, but here are the 6 antidotes I have to take for the drug. And then, you know, all of a sudden the caries index comes up, their perio starts to advance, and their mouth is dry as hell from these drugs. That's an important point too. What are you taking? So the standard of care, really, of course, risk assessments themselves, you know, prophys, education, you know, home care, critical. Microscopic analysis, which we'll touch on, it's a nice assessment. DNA analysis, BANA testing, you can check that out. Irrigation, root planning and scaling, supplementation, nutritional supplementation, pocket reduction procedures. Yeah, I haven't done surgeries since I was in dental school. That was nuts. And frequent recall appointments. And that's always kind of an interesting thing, frequent recall appointments. Where did we come up with 3 and 6 months? Where the hell did that come from? Is that an insurance thing or what? Within 90 days, they'll become bad again. Them bugs will be bad. 90 days? I just showed you a film, and one day all those creeps came back. You know, a couple of hours. My goodness. So what we do now is we really customize to what the patient needs, not, you know, the parameters of what we think it should be, what they need. Some people need, you know, come in every couple of months for a touch-up. Some can, you know, it's amazing. Sometimes you're talking to a patient, like I talked to him a month ago, it's been a year, and the teeth are beautiful. So customizing their recall appointments and what they necessarily need. Laser therapy, LINAP therapies, oxygen ozone therapy. We like that. That's always a fun one. We'll talk about it a little bit too. So you have to come up with a good diagnosis. That's for sure. And we got all kinds of slick tricks. But you got to come up with a diagnosis and traditional stuff, bleeding upon probing, you know, the depth of pockets, you know, Florida probe. You got to do all these fundamental things, mobility, dentition. Those are all understanding the basic concepts. BANA testing, okay? And BANA testing, really, it's kind of like an enzyme assessment, microbial enzyme assessment of some basic fundamental bugs that are in there. What it does is, it's what I call these assessments, because I don't hang my hat absolutely on these things. They tend to develop a picture, an assessment concept, okay? So there's a positive correlation, both clinically and statistically, between BANA test results and the current stage of periodontal destruction. It has no reflection on the quantity of the problem, but it has more of the quality issue. So BANA testing is a nice assessment. And these are these little tricks here, there, and even the DNA testing is, once again, educating the patient. I find, you know what, they're more useful in educating the patient of what's going on than the reality of it, okay, or getting in there and treating it. And once again, it just follows up, leaving with the oral DNA testing. And I've done that, oral DNA testing, Hahn testing, all that, you know, for a number of years. And really, it's important that you give the patient a copy of that so they have an assessment. But unfortunately, I don't know about you, anybody do the DNA testing here at all? It's almost like, you know, this. They want you to do the same drugs. It's the same thing every time. But some of the therapies we have, I don't care what the hell's there. But what they forget about, how many people think about parasites in the oral cavity? Parasites, man. Maybe we'll get lucky. And this is always a good one. Well, I'm jumping ahead of myself. But when we have a microscope in the, you know, the vendor area, it's always good when poor dentist sits there and Bill takes a little sample of that, puts it on a slide, and looks on the phase contrast microscope, and here comes an amoeba. And Bill turns and looks. You have an amoeba's in your mouth. And the dentist goes, Then the word goes out. Everybody starts showing up. He's got an amoeba in his mouth. Stay away. And hopefully you see the amoeba eating neutrophils. That's kind of freaky. While it's eating your head. Amoeba, we love them. So the DNA polymerase chain reaction, basically what they're doing is looking at a number of the more prevalent type of bacterium, doing a DNA from a DNA patient spitting in a little thing, they do an analysis, and then you'll get a nice little report. We'll call it orange, green, yellow, whatever the hell it is. The only problem I have with that, they said, well, we suggest putting all these antibiotics in their head. It's always the same antibiotics type of therapy, which, okay, whatever. Well, here it is. The usual recommendation, amoxicillin, you know, TID, 8 days. Metronidazole, 500 milligrams, BID, for 8 days. Arestin, suppository. No. What? Arestin, chlorhexidine, okay? Yeah, well, okay, that's kind of cool. As the patient lives in the bathroom, as their bowel is blown out. So I'm not a big fan of antibiotics because we have other cool tricks we can do. But this is always the same recommendation. That's it. You know, you did it. You see the same thing coming back again and again and again. And sometimes, you know what? In the integrative model, sometimes you need antibiotics. Don't be so biologic. I will never use an antibiotic. If they have the patients like this, you need an antibiotic, okay? Sometimes you need it, but that's some of the fundamental recommendations, and chlorhexidine, which is always good. I prefer Clorox from the jar, but that's another story. So we talked about the microscope as a phase contrast system. Basically, you're taking a sampling of the crevicular fluid, placing it on a slide, and then looking through the phase contrast microscope. And here's an amoeba on the left side. I just get excited looking at that. Anyhow, and of course the bacteria. And it's, once again, it's an assessment. It's a good educational tool. It might give you an idea of what's there. But as you know, if you study microbiology, you know, by the time you remove your sample from that ecological environment, you lost like probably 99% of what the hell's there. Okay? And no one talks about fungus. There's fungus amongst us. What's the biggest problem with root canals? Fungus, man. You know, we started doing ozone therapies on root canals and stuff. We did a lot of research, and it was like, holy cow. We're blasting away patients. What's the first thing you give a patient with a root canal problem? Antibiotics. What's happening? Fungal infections coming up. You know, so fungus is amongst us on there. We don't talk about that too much. So everything is growing everywhere. So some of the simple home care things, which are kind of cool. You know, we love oil pulling with coconut oil. That's popular these days. You know, then the traditional Ayurvedic model, it's organic sesame seed oil. That's fun. You know, these things raise the consciousness of the patient, okay, and their overall health. Vitamins and mineral supplementation. Trace minerals, I can't tell you how important it is. There's a company called Marco Farmer, which I love, and they have a wonderful trace mineral formula called Somoplex 21. That is phenomenal for epithelial cells. Vitamins and proper supplementation and nutrition are important to what? Nurture the matrix, circulation, and ultimately the cell. Healing, you know, taking ginseng, peppermint, chamomile tea, all those things that get in there help stimulate healing, circulation. Poultices, we can all use tea tree oil, but you got to watch some of these things, your yellow root and myrrh, but these poultices that you can really, you know, actually burn yourself, especially with tea tree, melaleuca, that's out. Nice anti-inflammatories, you know, calendula extract. Boreon makes a wonderful calendula salve. That's wonderful stuff. Calendula is amazing for healing wounds. And aloe vera juice, turmeric. Turmeric is another wonderful extract. You get the powder and take a little turmeric every day. Man, it's amazing how it reduces down the inflammatory components in your body. Very simple. And ginseng itself, it's a prepare for circulation. And another great one, I don't have it up there, is ginger extract. You know, if you're going to juice a little bit, always throw a little ginger in there. Man, that gets the dynamite. You get you going in the morning. And, of course, your traditional or non-traditional green teas with your antioxidants. These are fundamental health, you know, issues that we're addressing here on the body as a whole. And we're reflecting there. You have to nurture the gut itself. So it's really, you know, another typical patient. I mean, how does this happen? How did someone get to the point where your tooth is laying sideways in your mouth? Well, it does. So inflammation-wise, how do we deal with inflammation? Well, you can give anti-inflammatories, of course, but inflammation in general, consider enzyme therapies. Anybody familiar with the concept of enzyme therapies? If you take like digestive enzymes to help your digestion, if you take those enzymes away from meals, they actually act as a nice, gentle anti-inflammatory, okay? World Nutrition has a wonderful formula called Vitalzymes. Those are great natural anti-inflammatories to take in between. If you have an inflamed case, I mean, another trick, a little formula is if you can take digestive, good quality digestive enzymes. If you take, if you have inflammation going on, take three, well, I use Marcozymes from Marco Pharma. You take three of those capsules every hour for about 24 hours, except when you're sleeping, of course. Massively reduces inflammation in the oral cavity and the body itself. Sprains, you know, injuries, etc. Think about it. Investigate enzyme therapies. We have an enzyme expert back there. Janet, is that you back there? We're all looking at you now. Enzyme therapy, it's a wonderful thing. I wish I had more time to talk about that, but we don't. An anti-inflammatory diet, you know, things we talk about, avocados, sweet potatoes, broccoli, all the things we love, chocolate cake, cheesecake, steak, barbecue, berries, blueberries, colorful things, you know, all those natural things we love, coconut oil, olive oil, salmon, beets, peppers, colorful vegetables, all those things are nice anti-inflammatory diets you can talk to your patients about to support them. But it's interesting, you know, we have in our practice, you know, the holistic moms come in and all that, and a lot of these, you know, people, I'm eating all organic stuff, they do all this kind of crazy stuff, and then they open their mouth, broken teeth, periodontal disease, it drives me nuts. You're taking this amazing food, you know, I won't eat anything that's not organic and, you know, non-GMO and, you know, everything, you know, even the kale is free range, you know. You know, grass-fed. You open up, the teeth are rotted out. That's great. You're taking your grass-fed kale and you're chewing it and you're destroying it with that infection. You gotta love it. Anyhow, so xylitol has become a big thing as a sugar substitute, you know, bacterial reduction. Basically, you're starving the bacteria. There's some controversies around it. Are we using too much of it? So it's just a thought out there. It comes in all kinds of pace. And, of course, the source. You know, there's some sources that are more toxic than others. So you really have to watch the source of the xylitol issue. I think that has to play out. Listen, over the years, I found that there's always fads and things. You know, about a year or two ago, vitamin D was the big thing. Everything, vitamin D, vitamin D. And now it's, you know, oils and this and stuff. You know, just watch and just see how things play out. And we'll see how xylitol really plays itself out. But that seems to be doing some supportive work there. But there can be no substitute for getting in there and brushing and flossing, you know, doing your proxy brushing, which we love, and doing some really non-toxic rinsing. You know, you can use chlorhexidine. I'm really not a big fan of that because there's other wonderful products like tooth and gum tonic, PerioClear. There's other alternatives. And I've always had really good luck with tooth and gum tonic and PerioClear. I mean, those have been really two good products that, you know, we've used over the years and worked very well. Because you know what? Like I said before, no matter what you do, you can scrape clean, do all kinds of cool stuff. If they're not keeping their mouth clean, it doesn't mean a thing. And that's the bottom line. And we love home irrigation. In our office, you know, we'll give them you know, the bottles of tooth and gum or PerioClear, a little irrigator. And a lot of times we give them ozonated water also. We make up ozonated water, which is an incredible solvent itself. And has wonderful effects. We'll show you in a few minutes. And we give them frozen ice cubes of ozonated water to take home with them and let it melt in their mouth and all kinds of cool stuff. And the classic home care, you know, salt and baking soda, you know, neutralizing the acid. And I guess the salt kind of makes you pucker up a little bit. But those are traditional kind of home care concepts. But once again, I mean, the bottom line, you know, if they don't clean their mouth, you know, nothing we do will really work. Okay. So I'd encourage you for lunch today. There you go. Okay. So, you got a problem with that? So, we want to get in there and start our perio treatment. We got a diagnosis, you know, this and that, whatever the case may be. We like to now, if possible, clean the house. Get in there and try to clean everything up, whether, you know, usually we can do both arches, have them in there if they're healthy and strong enough. Get in there and clean it up. Okay, try to make a dramatic change in that environment, and I'll show you how that story develops now. So clean up that house, because believe me, that ain't further from some people's oral cavities. That is for sure. So periodontal treatment and outcome protocols. So we'll just go through this a little bit. You kind of just get a sense of it. I can't, you know, my goal today is not make you periodontist. Just to think a little bit differently, and I'll use my little bit of my ozone model to help you think that way. So you have to perform normal diagnostics. Even though you got all kinds of cool tricks, you have to get in there and poke at them, do all the kind of stuff to do your normal diagnostic workups. You know, you can do your comprehensive diagnosis, do your microscopic analysis if you like, do your Banda testing, all those assessments so you have a big picture for the patient. Like I said, all those assessments are great for educating the patient. Florida probing is kind of cool, makes a printout, you know, makes them all kind of happy, like, hey, this is really happening. And of course, your treatment cycle is really dependent on the patient and what's best for the patient itself. You know, people love going in there with the laser. We use laser also in combination with other therapies. That's been effective, getting there with the LINAP, you know, laser-assisted attachment procedures. And that seems to be working good and bad. Once again, it's dependent on the patient. I mean, I've had patients I shipped off to have all this stuff done. Fantastic. I'm cured. They don't have to follow up. No. It's a process. They have to stay with it and maintain and make sure they come back, okay? So, you know, healing periodontal disease, can you imagine healing with only oxygen and water? I'm going to use my ozone model, but you can substitute, I'll substitute other things into it, but we found this a very effective model, extremely safe and effective model to treat periodontal disease and soft tissue issues itself. Now, the beauty of, you know, of ozone therapy is that it basically can clean out everything. It's the ultimate universal disinfectant. Whether it's parasitic, viral, fungal, or bacterial, okay? It cleans it out. The beauty of it is, this is the fun part, is that we use all the different modalities of ozone therapy. We irrigate, we insufflate, which means blow into, we infuse, we use saturation techniques, we use actually trays that flow moisturized oxygen ozone over complete arches. An application, we use ozonated olive oil, which is an amazing, amazing healing salve, which is wonderful for problematic spots. So ozone was interesting with ozone as we developed this story over the last 13, 15 years, really, at this point, or more, is ozone is what the body does to deal with infection in the system. They found that over the years that ozone is produced, the first study showed that ozone is produced by antibodies in a killing. So antibodies actually have, other than a marking component, they produce ozone. They start killing the pathogenic forms in cell. What they came to realize also, which is very interesting, is that the neutrophils, the macrophages, you know, we always thought, you know, let's say a macrophage comes along, finds a bacteria, reaches out, grabs it, brings it into his system, pinocytosis, all that kind of cool stuff. And then we always thought, well, it must be the, you know, those enzyme systems within the individual immune cell that kills the bug. No. What they found was, they found it interesting, especially neutrophils. Neutrophils used to pack themselves, which still do obviously, pack themselves with vitamin C, ascorbic acid. They said, why do neutrophils pack itself with a quiescent form of vitamin C? Well, what happens is through this water killer catalytic pathway, those cells, the immune cells, are producing ozone to kill and puncture the membrane of the bacteria. And those neutrophils or macrophages, they're packing themselves with vitamin C to protect itself from destroying itself. So as an antioxidant reserve, the quench the oxidative stress is creating to kill the pathogenic forms. So in ozone therapy, why we love it so much is that all it's doing is what the body does itself naturally on the immunologic level. We're just supporting that process. So ozone effectively eliminates bacteria, fungus, virus, parasites without any toxic side effects if you use it in the appropriate fashion. So this was a study done a while ago, but I loved it because it was very simple. Just using ozonated water itself. Now you can use iodine, okay, all these other different chemicals, but we usually use ozonated water. This is only at 4 micrograms per cc of ozone entrapped in water, which is very light. We can see at the top we have distilled water and ozonated water, and then ozonated water after 120 seconds with the bacteria. Distilled water had maybe a little osmolarity effect on the cells. But the ozonated water, as soon as it struck those cells, they started to rupture and the membrane swelled. Within 120 seconds, they were obliterated just in simple ozonated water itself. Ozonated water. When you create ozonated water, you create it fresh. And the interesting thing about ozonated water, you always make it with distilled water. And what it becomes is really a universal solvent. The surfactant levels in the water, bond angles actually change. You know, it's interesting when you make distilled water. You know, distilled water, when you bubble the water away, the bond angles between the oxygen and hydrogen molecules kind of pop out to about 120 degrees and then collapses down to 101. Well, it's really kind of dead water, we call it. It's really not biologic reactive. You know, healthy, good water, the bond angle relationship between the oxygen and hydrogen molecules about 104, maybe 106 degrees, which allows for some good saturation in the system. What happens when ozonated water is ozonated, the bond angles pop out to 109 degrees, so the water becomes a perfect tetrahedron, which allows for massive absorption. It easily flows through the system. The absorption is extremely increased and allows for a universal true solvent right there. So other than carrying the ozone through, it's a solvent and it washes things away, which is a wonderful thing also. So fluorescein, you know, fluorescence microscopic analysis, showed with distilled water, blue is vitality, nothing. Ozonated water, instant blighting, and then with 120 seconds, pretty much kill the area. Well, that's good. We kind of know that. You know, the science in ozone is steep. It goes back years. The volume of research behind even dental ozone now is well into 300-400 articles published in PubMed, which is pretty amazing at this point, just skyrocketing with the work that's being done. But what was important out of this study was the biofilm. Okay? We showed the ozonated water came in and just washed away the biofilm. At a low oxidative level, washed that biofilm away and broke up the biofilm. And that's the most critical aspect. Why? We discussed that before. You have to get through the biofilm to get to the pathogenic forms. And the ozonated water allows us to do that. So that's kind of cool right there. So one of the first things that we do, and this is, you know, from Dr. Kennedy. You know, he likes to use iodine. Did I hit that button again? There it is. He'll use iodine or different type of chemicals. I like ozone in water. Is we go in there and actually irrigate all the pockets out using ozonated water. We fabricate the water and irrigate those pockets out. So we call it sulcus pathogenic reduction lavage.
But a rough night, we made that up, believe me. In other words, we rinse out the pockets, okay? Well, now we know from what the studies have shown that we irrigate those pockets out. Why is it important before I start going in there with my Cavitron and all that kind of stuff? Why is it important that I go in there and rinse all those pockets out? Well, reducing down, you know, bacteremia, septicemia. Some of these patients we have are compromised. So it debulks those pockets, which is really nice. All of Dr. Kennedy there. And we can see, you know, microbial, the issue why microorganisms like that are so susceptible to oxidative stress is that they lack antioxidants or very little antioxidant systems in their cell membranes. That's the key. That's the universal link with all these pathogenic forms. They lack antioxidant systems in the cell membrane. So you oxidatively stress them, you rupture their membranes, and you create, you know, you kill them. It's a whole biologic cascade, which we don't really have time to get into. But you can see in this study hydrogen peroxide. And the interesting thing when you're using ozone or iodine, you can see iodine up there. Remember mercuricone? When I was a kid, we painted ourselves with mercury all the time, pink all the time. So that's there also. But with oxygen, when you use oxygen ozone, once you introduce the ozone into a biologic system, the ozone, okay, which is the triatomic oxygen, instantly disappears at light speed. The ozone comes and goes. The result of the exposure is hydrogen peroxides, peroxide forms. So the ozone isn't the ozone traveling around. It's a conversion, a biologic conversion, instantly into hydrogen peroxide. Now, those peroxide forms themselves is what carries the oxidative stress. And the beauty of it also is it carries an electrical charge that is negative, negatively charged. What is infection and inflammation? What kind of charge does that carry? Positive charge. Remember, inflammation, infection is very acidic, so it's a positive charge. So you always let the ozone do the thinking for you, which is nice. So, you know, if we do our irrigation, we go up there and do our mechanical deprimant, the scaling, root planting and all that, which is fun. You can do the whole arch or the whole mouth. And this was kind of something I just popped in the other day. I was cruising around, seeing what can I add? Perioscopy. Has anybody heard about that? Oh, you use it? How is that? Yeah, this was an interesting, it's like, I guess, endoscopy of for perio pockets. So this is something that I just came across. I'm going to check it out a little bit. But you actually go, it's kind of an interesting thing. We're saying you kind of hold the scope as you're scaling. So a lot of times, listen, we're going, maybe you're burnishing the calculus. I don't know, maybe you don't know what you're doing. Right. We don't know what we're doing. Of course we don't know what we're doing. Now we can see. Maybe that's not a good thing. I can see. So how is it manipulation-wise? Can I have to... Hygienist? Well, the hygienists are much more talented than us. We know that for a fact. Any hygienists here? Now you're talking. There you go. All right. Those are my favorite students, hygienists. They actually learn. So that's something I'm going to have to check out. That's pretty interesting, actually, going down there. It might be scary down there, but especially somebody looking back at you, who knows what's down there. So anyhow, so this is where, with oxygen ozone, what we like to do is if we do the irrigation, the mechanical debridement, get our perioscope out now, we're looking down there, wow, it looks perfect. We go in there and actually take ozonated gas and bubble it down the pocket itself. And ozonated gas goes instantly into solution, okay? Instantly into solution. It's not air. It's pure oxygen and ozone. So it instantly goes into solution, produces those peroxides. And the beauty about going in and insufflating and blowing into pockets is that once it goes into the solution, the peroxides itself will go out into the epithelial area here, number one, disinfect the pocket, but also desensitize the root. Ozone's amazing for desensitization of roots themselves. It's one of the greatest little tricks. Everybody says, well, Phil, how does it work? I don't know. But, you have an exposed root, it's problematic. You ozonate it for 60 seconds. It's amazing. And it lasts. Always gas. Yeah, always gas. So this is when I talk about insufflation, I'm talking about gassing the pocket itself. So this is beyond, You can use iodine, water, whatever the case may be. This is another step up. This is like the rocket fuel in the pocket themselves. They are always running about, yeah, probably around the 20 microgram range. 20 microgram range, which is good disinfecting and desensitizing. And this is the dental ozone unit itself with the little dental handpiece that comes off. You have a little foot pedal that you can actually place the gas directly down into the pocket itself, which is pretty cool. You can see the handpiece, little side delivery cannula. There we go. Okay. And here's the technique. Basically going up in the pocket itself, have a saliva ejector adjacent to the tooth, desensitize it. And we can see here where it's going up in the pocket itself. Just like that. And one thing I learned from Dr. Kennedy was that a number of years ago, that you really don't need much bone to keep teeth in your head. And in this particular case, here's a 1 week that we're going up there. You can see we get peroxide formation. We have a little bleeding coming up there. The gas will go in solution, go back a week later. We're not getting any kind of bleeding at all, poking away like crazy. And there was one great slide, I guess I don't have it in here. There was really little to no bone up in there, okay? So when you think about perio, we've been going, you know, traditionally going there, putting medicaments in the pockets, okay? We've been going, everything we do is inside the pocket itself, cleaning out the pocket itself. We've never gone outside the pocket. And one of our procedures we like to do is we call it vascular enhancement procedure, where what we want to do is get into the deep vascular beds. You know, we want to stimulate re-regulation of periodontal plexus, open up non-functional compromised vascular beds, get the matrix open and functioning, getting, you know, and cytokines, the blood, and get the anti systems going up again. So what we do is actually take ozone itself at a low microdose, and we actually place some ozone down at the base of the tissue itself in the buccal fold. Ozone gas instantly, once again, goes in the solution. And the beauty of the parallel, one of the chemicals that are produced, or the cytokines that are produced, is nitric oxide. What is nitric oxide so important? Nitric oxide used to be called endothelial relaxation factor. It opens up the vascular beds. So by placing ozone into the deep vascular beds here, now we're treating periodontal disease, okay, helping the patient heal themselves by getting into the, you know, getting into the deeper tissue itself. Traditional periotherapy has always been in here. Everything we do has been here, in this pocket, okay? Now we've irrigated it, we've smooth cleaned everything out, got all the goop out of there, we've insufflated it, we've got some peroxides going here, desensitized the roots. But now with that technique, just a little ozone gas, we come down at the base here and we're able to get those peroxide forms, nitric oxide, deep into these vascular beds. And now we're treating from here out. When you talk about ozone therapy, you always think about terms of how am I going to deliver all the things that it produces, all the peroxides, all the lipid peroxides, all the nitric oxide, all those wonderful things that we want to get the healing process. So if you're talking about a mandible, how else would we deliver into the deeper structures of the bone to support the deeper bony structures? Take a little ozone gas and put it by an inferior alveolar, a cc or two. Okay? So what that does, it will go into the solution, be picked up by the neurovascular bundle, and all those byproducts of ozone will be drawn deep down into that bone. So now when we're talking about supporting structures, deeper structures, opening up vascular beds, disinfection on multiple levels. We've transcended away from just pocket therapy. We're doing all the supportive therapies deep within the structures itself. The same thing for the maxilla. Everybody loves a palatal infusion. Sometimes you got to do that. But also think about the superior alveolar, dropping a little ozone there as you're treating here. It'll go deep into those deeper bony structures and help support that healing process there. So that's the beauty of that. And this is what we're trying to open up, because we open up those capillary loops, the oral epithelium, the blood starts to flow again, the congestion starts to go away, the matrix becomes what? Starts to regulate again, detoxify, and that's going to reflect into what? The tissue. The epithelium. We're going in a deeper sense. We're looking differently. We're thinking differently. We're opening up all these systems. We're draining these systems out. And you can go and you can poke individual little papilla with low micrograms of ozone to help stimulate the healing process itself. So that's just a fundamental slip through on the perio. talk about the microbiome. When we clean up our perio patients, we like to reimplant, restoration of the microbiome. So what we try to do is to elevate the consciousness of the patients through probiotics. Okay, there are specific dental probiotics out there now. Okay, that I want to see how those really pan out. But what we do is we take, in our particular case, we love HMF Forte. It's a wonderful probiotic formula from Sea Royal Genestra. So what we do is after a perio treatment, we'll make up a little syringe of probiotic and some saline, and we clean up the whole mouth, and we'll actually irrigate those pockets with probiotics. Then the patient can swallow those also because the good probiotics through the whole system. The human-based, good formulation, good certified functional units in that. So we irrigate those pockets and create a different flora within the pockets and get them on probiotic therapy. Now, why is so probiotic therapy so important? Because, once again, you're nurturing the gut. One of our mantras at our school is to weed, feed, and seed the GI tract. Weed, feed, and seed. So we're constantly putting probiotics into the system. It stimulates the immune system and also creates a good flora. A friend of ours who taught us all this stuff, Dr. Ali, brilliant physician, he says, I am no longer a physician. I am a gardener. Like being there. Because once again, if you nurture the GI tract, okay, nurture the gut from the oral cavity all the way through, you're going to be a different ecology, different health, different wellness in the long run. You have to nurture your gut. And by nurturing your gut, you start right at the oral cavity. You have an infected, dysfunctional oral cavity. Believe me, it's a reflection of the whole system. Hey, you look at a new patient, they're frothy, their tongue, has all different types of growth on a fungal growth. This is just not a local phenomenon. Okay, this is a whole body effect. So we get some saline solution, mix it up, and then once again, we irrigate those pockets out and give them a little probiotic to start them for their home care. Now, like I said, there's a different Evoflora. There's all different oral probiotics that are theoretically specific to the oral cavity. I'm waiting to see how that really works out, but I know the super powder works extremely well. And it raises, once again, their consciousness on their health and general wellness. An assessment and recall, after we get a patient stabilized, we usually have them back about 4 or 5 weeks, take a look at them, touch things up, and then, once again, customize what their specific needs are as far as recall appointments. I mean, I have patients out there that, come back every 6, 8 weeks with a little touch-up, a little ozone therapy, whatever the case may be, and have them back. And keep their consciousness up. So the reality on all the things I spoke about today, it's really a matter of ecology and really different type of thinking. Think biologically. Think a little bit different. Think about what this patient's specific needs are. Why are these things occurring? I mean, why are they chronically having periodontal problems? Okay, is it occlusion, the dental stuff? Is it, their gut issues? What transcends that? Is there medication? It's getting a little bit more complex, but you know what? It's more of an intellectual thing than anything, which is kind of a real fun thing, especially in the integrative model itself. So it's all a matter of ecology and, of course, getting some vitamin D. There you go. Thank you very much. Elvis has left the building. Done. How much time? Do we have any time? What time is it now? You meet at 12 o'clock, right?
We did 12. They're going over there.
You want to go? Well, we got a couple of minutes. If you want to ask any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. I changed my mind. Forget it. I will not run for president. Go ahead. It's Marco Pharma. The company's name Marco Pharma. They're out in Roseburg, Oregon. And it's called Somaplex 21. It's S-O-M-A, Plex, P-L-E-X, 21. That's really, when you're trying to rebuild bone, you're trying to get them the tissue much better. Even for your own health and wellness, I'm telling you, trace minerals are always overlooked. It's an incredible formula. It covers a multitude of different issues as far as I know, all across the board. That's a great, great formula to use. Somaplex 21.
Root canal.
just talking now. You're not putting on.
What's that?
You're talking to that. You're not putting on.
I talk to this? Can you hear me now? We're swapping off, I say.
Hi. Do you find that root canals are a source of perio, or you have a difficulty and it just keeps coming back and it's from the root canals?
Root canals is what I call the biologic conundrum, okay? We love and hate root canals at the same time. You know, my partner and I, which is my dear wife back there, went out and we bought an iCat just to look at root canals and bone issues because we're doing a lot of ozone research. And what the interesting thing is, on old root canals, it's kind of spooky, some of the stuff you find on iCats we've never seen before, you know, big cysts, etc. But yeah, I mean, the problem with root canals is the toxins they produce. We know that. You know, are old root canals bad? No, I don't think so. You know, sometimes we can maintain them immunologic, etc. I mean, I love to get a hold of root canals when I can fumigate the hell out of them with root canal with ozone. But yeah, there's a correlation. The biggest problem, like I said, I alluded to before, with root canals were fungal infections. You know, we're pounding away on the bacteria and the fungal infection, the gliotoxins, all this type of toxic material is out, and that's going to definitely create an ischemic, you know, problem with the bone. I mean, who loves taking out root canal teeth? Yeah, I know you do, hon. You're a bad boy back there. I mean, it just drives me nuts taking root canal. I think it's chip, crack, chip, crack, chip, crack. But, yeah, I mean, there's a definitive correlation between a toxic tooth and bone loss and periodontal disease. That's for sure. So are root canal, all root canals bad? No. The student only in here probably stabbed me when he sees me. Yes? Well, ozone, well, our endos all revolve around the concept of ozone, okay? So we'll do, you know, the standard stuff, you know, open up the tooth, get the canals opened up. We use a chelating agent because we want to get rid of the smear layer, that's for sure. We actually file with ozonated oil, so we're disinfecting and lubricating at the same time. So we'll rinse that all out with ozonated water, and then we'll use a chelating agent to open up all the tubules. Because if you think about what are the tubules in a tooth? An extension of what? Extension of the odontoplast, okay? They're not empty, dry holes, okay? They're cytoplasmic-filled tubules, so there's fluid in there. But that's to our advantage ozone-wise. Because once we irrigate out the tooth itself, dry it up a little bit, we'll take close to 60 micrograms per cc, and each root slowly fumigate ozone gas directly down in each canal. So what it's doing is we're getting that conversion of the ozone gas into peroxides. If there's any kind of inflammation or infection within the tubules themselves, those peroxides will travel up through those tubules and sterilize those the best they can. Now, and then you fill it, whatever. You know, the big argument, and it was interesting years ago, used to be, oh, it's got to be the filling material, you know, endocal, this and that. You know, that's not the issue. The issue is the structure of a biologic system. Now, is that 100% fix? Probably not. But what I do with my root canal patients is that when we do root canals, hey, you know, I hate to make dental cripples out of people, but if a tooth is bad, I'm going to take it out. But if it's structurally sound and we can save it, I give them that option, and I give them all the good, the bad, the ugly with it. But we put them on, you know, kind of like endo recalls. I'll have them back, and there are techniques with ozone that we can maintain the health and wellness around that tooth by thinking, how am I going to deliver those peroxides, by doing different type of infusion techniques to make it as safe as possible to maintain that tooth. So yeah, I love the term fumigate, because we fumigate the hell out of that. With that, and also, tomorrow when I talk about ozone, about caries arrestment, it's a very similar technique for caries, because we can avoid root canals. With ozone, you can do that. You know, you oxidize, change the dentin, and allow for remineralization to occur, and you can save the root canal, which is nice.